Hello, this is Hida, and I'm here today to talk to you about why I think it is the markup that matters. It is the markup that matters if we want the web to be accessible. And wasn't it Sir Tim Berners-Lee who said it, the power of the web is in its universality? He wants the web to be accessible for all. And by that, we mean that it is accessible for people with permanent disabilities, people who have temporary disabilities, for instance, they've broken their arm during a skiing holiday, or people in certain situations, like a father carrying their baby while they're trying to use their phone with one hand. All of this accessibility is the responsibility of everyone on the team, and that includes content people, UX people, CMS integrators, user researchers, but also web developers, and that's what my focus will be today. I'll be talking about what we can do as developers to make the web more accessible, and that includes things like improving our code to work with assistive technologies. Now, assistive technologies are tools that people with disabilities often use in order to use the web and computers in general in a way that works for them. For instance, people who cannot see the screen might use a screen reader that reads out everything that happens on the screen to them. Or they might use a Braille display that will turn everything on the screen into Braille in real time. If you go to a website like nextjs.org/conv, it's going to obviously show you the website, but in the background, the browser is going to be sent a bunch of HTML. Now, this HTML gets turned into a DOM tree by the browser, and if you're using a framework that abstracts this away into a virtual DOM and deals with the DOM for you, you're still going to get a DOM tree. And what many people don't know is that there is actually a second tree out there, which is called the accessibility tree. It is how your web page gets exposed to assistive technologies. About each node in your page, it's going to contain things like, what kind of thing is this? Is this a button or a link? How should we refer to it? Is it the search button or is it the first name input? And it contains things like states and properties, whether something is expanded or not. So here's an example of an accessibility tree. It could be things like a slider that has the actions increment and decrement. The name is departure time and the minimum is 0 and the maximum 24. It could be a search button that is called search and it has an action that you can press it. All these kinds of things exist in accessibility trees and they get automatically generated based on what is available in the DOM. So if we want to write accessible code, we basically need to tell machines what stuff is. We need to tell machines what stuff is called, and we need to tell machines what state stuff is in. So in order for assistive technologies to work, they need to know what is happening on a screen. And they find out about this through platform APIs. And platform APIs exist in all the big platforms like Windows and Mac and mobile. All these systems have platform APIs that know everything about the system itself. But as soon as you go into a browser and you type in a web address, it may have never seen that website before, so it's going to have to figure out on the fly what's going on your website. Now, this is where the accessibility tree comes in. It has a representation of the website with all the accessibility info taken out. So this is what is going to inform the platform APIs about what's happening in a website. Now, as I said before, it is based directly on the DOM tree, which is based on our markup. Hence my statement, it is the markup that matters, because with our markup, we can directly influence what assistive technologies know about our web pages. Now, the accessibility tree can be found in all the big browsers. In all of these, you can inspect the accessibility tree and figure out what's going on in there. So it is the markup that matters. So let's look at a couple of different bits of markup that you can use and to make your site more useful in assistive technologies. For instance, to answer the question, what is this page? You can make sure that there is a title element in the top of your page and that it always represents what's currently in the page. Even if you've routed somewhere else, you need to make sure that's updated to something relevant. So that someone who uses a screen reader like Leonie Watson shows in a video of Smashing TV, if you end up on a page in a screen reader, it's going to read out the title element's content. Headings are another great way to make your site more usable. And then I'm talking about H1, H2, H3, all these sorts of different heading elements. Headings are kind of like the API to your website for screen reader users, because often they will use a pattern called navigate by heading. They will use their screen reader's menus to pull up a list of headings, which then lets them choose where to go on a page. So basically they navigate using these headings. So we need to make sure that the name of the heading really clearly specifies what's in a given section. Landmarks, another important way to let people figure out what's on your page. With a landmark, you can distinguish different sections on your page, like headers and footers, navigation elements, those sorts of things. Or you can use their ARIA equivalent. But as Bruce Lawson said, built-in beats bolt-ons. So always be using native HTML elements where you can, because they are supported much more widely than ARIA is. So if you want to use headers, footers, aside, nav, and main, beware that what you're doing, you're defining regions in your page, and if you give them names, then people will be able to navigate by landmark to important landmarks on your page. Form controls are incredibly important HTML elements. When WebAIM, a nonprofit from the US, looked at 1 million web pages, they found that 60% of them didn't properly label their inputs. Now, inputs are easy to label, and we need to do it for input fields, radio buttons, checkboxes, select text areas. All of these things need to have labels so that they have names in the accessibility tree. So if you have an input for first name and you type the words first and name right in front of it, it's going to visually label that input. But if you look in the accessibility tree, it's going to have a name of null or empty string. If you want to know exactly how names get computed, you can look at the accessible name and description computation specification. But generally, if you use a label element in your HTML that has a for attribute that refers to the ID attribute of the input, you are connecting these two, and it's going to take the contents of the label as the accessible name. So it's going to compute to first name in this case. Table semantics are another great way that you can let AT users figure out your website much more easily. The right table elements are really going to help make your table more easy to navigate. What to look out for in a table? One is a caption element, because that names the table. Others are TH elements that will describe headings inside tables. And then there is the scope attribute that's going to let you say this name is for a row or for a column. So you're saying what it applies to. If there is no meaningful markup for the component that you're trying to build, ARIA can provide names and roles and properties, basically everything that exists in an accessibility tree through attributes. Note that usually there is existing HTML for a problem, so if you combine existing elements, that's usually better, and not all ARIA has support or provides a good user experience for AT users. So keep that in mind when you use ARIA. In some occasions, though, ARIA is a great way to enrich your user experience for people who use assistive tech. For instance, if you have something that can expand, like a tooltip, you can use ARIA controls to specify what element is being controlled or hidden and shown in the case of a tooltip. And then you can use ARIA expanded to say whether it has expanded or not, setting it to true or false. Or when you are doing some kind of announcement, like with a toast element, you can use a div with a role of alert, put some content in, and then that's going to be read out by the screen reader or by the assistive tech. It needs to exist in the DOM before you do that, but then when it exists in the DOM, you put some content in, it's going to get read out as well. Now, these are all ways where you can influence the accessibility tree through markup. So this is where markup really matters. But if we look a bit at the future, one thing that is really interesting and exciting is the accessibility object model. It is a proposal from a bunch of different browser vendors that worked on this together, and it is currently in some browsers, not all, so it is future work and a bit speculative. But what it would be is a JavaScript API that allows developers to modify and eventually also look at the accessibility tree in an HTML page. It would fill gaps within ARIA and let you provide your own accessibility and maybe even test your accessibility through JavaScript. You can do things like setting semantics without markup, so setting it directly in JavaScript. You can avoid sprouting, so that is a thing where you copy-paste, for instance, a custom element, and you need to copy-paste a lot of attributes with it in order to get accessibility. With the accessibility object model, you would be able to build in those attributes into the element so that you don't need to copy-paste them, so that they become more portable. There is talk about having events in assistive technologies that would bubble up into your browser so that you can interact with them. There are some privacy concerns there, so they are still figuring out how to make that work. There's also talk about having elements that don't exist in the DOM and have them just in the accessibility tree. And then the last thing that would be in the accessibility object model is the ability to read the accessibility tree in JavaScript. And of course, that would be really exciting if you're testing your accessibility attributes. That would be very useful indeed. So, too long, didn't read. If you want to write components of a high quality, they need to be accessible. Now, good markup can really make a big difference, and it gives us a lot of accessibility for free without using ARIA. And whatever the markup is, you need to make sure that everything has a name and that everything has a state specified so that the accessibility tree can make sense of your page and tell assistive technology all about it, so that people find it easier to browse through your page using these technologies. Now that's all for me today. Thanks very much for listening. If you have any questions, feel free to send me a message on Twitter or contact me through my website. All of the slides and resources are available now on folks.hiddenfreeze.nl. Now thanks very much for watching.